That's the news revealed to us. It's going to be revealed right here between the two French dogs.
What's the hold up?
9 months.
Mila does not have a clue, but she just gonna feel that you're no longer the baby. It is good to be in God's house. We're so thankful to the Lord for his blessings upon French family, and how he's blessed them over the last 2 years, and they've got their work cut out for them, starting over again. There's several announcements that's following on the announcement screen in your bulletin, so be sure to see those announcements if you've not gotten Sister Debbie yet. You get your Sunday school books, we start them in order next week, so be sure to see her for that. You need applications turned in tonight. Later than tonight, for those who are planning to go on the youth trip on the 17th, we've got to get those turned in. And we've got a couple of fundraisers coming up for Sister Lexi. She's supposed to give me information on the one. Soon as she gets it to me, we'll start announcing that and get it in the bulletin. But we have 4 given t-shirts for sale. They're in the soda shop. It's $12 a shirt. Or if you buy 2 or 4, they're $10 a shirt. So be sure to, when you stop by the soda shop, see Sister Lexi about those, and all the proceeds from that's going to help go towards her hourly mission trip. And we've got a special event coming up on the 25th. We'll get you more information starting next week on that. Stand with me. Let's go to the Lord in prayer this morning. I'd like the Lord to have his way in this service today. We want to lift up our brothers and our sisters. If it's not able to be here, just need a touch in their body. Just continue to go through it. Stones, Brother Stone, for those who have not heard. Had another brain bleed this week, went to the hospital, and now he's not communicating. False use of the left side of his body. They say that it'll come back. It's been 48 hours now, and he's not able to communicate very much. No use of the left side of his body. So pray for him. Ask God to touch him. They say that what he has is incurable. It will just continue to happen, and ultimately will take his life. We know God is faithful to touch and to move. God's perfect will, and we want to be able to accept God's perfect will. Let's believe for God to touch him and to heal him and work a miracle on his behalf. And so many others. Sister Martha, she came home this week still in pain. Let's pray for her. And Brother Coleman with us. He finally made it. He's been in town for a little while, but Sister Coleman went straight to the hospital the day after they got here. She's now in life care, recovering. So lift her up in your prayers today and ask God to touch her as well. Father, we're grateful for the privileges we have to be here. There's a lot of needs, God. There's a lot of hurts. There's a lot of struggles that people are going through in their bodies, and we just pray that you would heal them.
Oh,
on page 116.
What?
about the transition. This process goes smooth. And I pray that, oh God, just to give peace, you know what is best. This family, God, I need you to touch them today. I need you to make a way. I need you to minister. This family.
Thank you.
God throughout the week of revival, sharing with us the messages that God placed upon their heart for our church. Now it's up to us to determine what we do, what we've been given. That's what I want to talk about this morning. The aftermath of revival. John chapter 3, verse 8. For those who've been with us for a little while, this is a rerun. I have preached this before. I felt that God would have me go in this direction again this morning. John chapter 3, verse 8. It said, "The wind bloweth where it listeth, and thou hearest the sound thereof, but cannot tell whence it cometh or whither it goeth. So is everyone that is born of the Spirit." Father, we love you and thank you today for the Word of God. Thank you for what the Word means to us. We find strength from the Word. We find strength from our time of prayer, commitment to you. And I pray this morning that this Word will speak to our hearts, draw us closer to you and your will, your way, your purpose, and your plan. And I pray, Heavenly Father, that you would just anoint us with the mighty anointing, God. We depend upon the anointing because the anointing is the difference today. We can't make it without you. We can't make it without your power, your presence, or your Spirit. If we do, we're just going through the motions. If we do, we're just making noise. Father, we never want to gather and just make noise. But we want to gather in accordance to your purpose and your will, accomplishing what you want to accomplish in this service today. I pray, God, that you would take into captivity every thought of every mind this morning. Bring into focus every heart, every soul, God, into divine purpose today. And I pray that you would place your sweet anointing upon me to preach. Place your anointing upon each hearer to receive. That our hearts would receive the word of God with gladness, that would not fall upon stony ground. God, it would fulfill the intent that you have for it to fulfill, touching hearts, lives, souls, and minds. Drawing us ever closer to you. We'll leave here today forever changed by the gospel. We give you the praise and the honor and the glory for it. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. You may be seated. The wind bloweth where it listeth, and thou hearest the sound thereof. Cannot tell where it came from or where it went. Cannot tell whence it cometh or whither it goeth. Said, so is every one that is born of the Spirit. That wind of God blowing into our lives. That wind of God that came into our hearts, our lives, and caused us to be newborn creatures in Christ Jesus. We look outside, we watch as nature, and we watch the limbs blow, the wind, we see leaves blowing. We cannot see the wind, we can see the effects of the wind. This relationship that we have with Christ Jesus, when His Spirit became relevant and real in our lives and blew into our lives, we didn't see a body figure show up. We didn't see the Spirit. God says, no, that God is a Spirit, and those who worship Him in spirit and in truth. But when that wind of the Holy Ghost, that wind of the Spirit blew into our lives, we didn't see where it came from. And we didn't see where it went, but we know where it came from. And we know where it's at. We know where it originated. And we know the purpose as we begin to study the Word of God. But He said that the wind, no one can tell where it came from. Nobody can tell where it goes. So it's everyone that is born of the Spirit. Now, when we think about revival, revival is not just a steady breeze on a cool day. Revival is not just another church service. Revival is not just a time that we take just haphazardly. We just go into without preparations. There have been times of spontaneous revival. There was a wind that blew. We broke out once in the School of Christ. We had a Wednesday night lesson. We went a second night of that. Why? Because there was a wind that we could not deny that began to blow through that place. A wind of revival. But revival comes like a storm. Revival comes with a powerful force. Revival comes with a mighty purpose. And it begins to bring great joy, great peace into the lives of those as it comes. But when we different, because when that wind begins to pick up in the natural realm, it brings a lot of destruction. Yeah. We've experienced that for a long time. We, here in Northeast Florida, we've felt ourselves to be exempt because of what the retired weatherman, Steve Smith, used to say. I laugh every time I hear him say it, is we've got an upper level low that seems to push down. When that storm is coming, we never worry too much about the storm because there was that jet stream, that upper level low that he would call it, that would drop down and it would always push the storm out to sea. We watched that 2 years ago with Matthew as it seemed to be on track for us. But we watched as it got pushed and just off the coast. We had some effects from it. When it was over, I went outside and picked up a limb out of my yard and it was over. Others had some other effects from it. But for so long, we felt like that we were indispensable. But then this past year, there was a little storm, a little Category 5 storm that began to barrel across the Atlantic Ocean that they named Irma. And Irma destroyed everything in its path. And it began to bring destruction through the islands. It began just to treat like speed bumps and go through it. And it came in a place that we're not used to storms making it here in this part of the country. It got over and it hit us from the left side. It hit us from the side even when the storm does come up the coast. Even if a storm was to hit the East Coast and hit Jacks Beach or Fernandina Beach or St. Augustine Beach or Daytona Beach, we don't really think a whole lot about it because we're so far inland. But this storm came on the other side. And when it came on the other side, our little town of Middleburg in Clay County, we began to see something that some of us have never seen in our life. A storm that they compared to the 100-year storm. A storm that brought Black Creek up to a level that it's never been before. Irma destroyed everything in its path. There was some folks. I've got some images. Sister Amy's going to begin to show here for you. Some houses that I went into personally after Irma came through to help. These people begin to clean out their homes, begin to make some sense of it. This is the aftermath of some homes that Irma affected. I talked to one lady as we were there helping clean out her house, and she said this: we were asleep in our bed, asleep. They had no expectation of what was going on outside. But by the time they woke up, the flood levels had already covered their garage. Halfway up, three-quarters of the way up their front door. Lost everything. Everything. The sun was shining outside the day that we were there. We had a big truck. There were people walking in and out of their house. We were carrying furniture out, doing all of these things. You walk out there, you look at that water. It's the most beautiful thing that you've ever saw. It was there, and the wind was not blowing anymore, but when that wind blew, it brought such destruction. Then when the sun revealed it the next day, you begin to see these images in the days to come and the weeks to come. You can still ride around Clay County and see trees, huge trees that were just blown over. You for a long time could see piles of debris and piles of people's furniture and things like that on the side of the road. And that is the aftermath. The storm was long gone, but the aftermath of it, the rebuilding process of it was there, and it's there for a long time to come. I heard just the other day that one-third of Puerto Rico is still without power. All of these months later, they still do not have electricity. It has caused utter chaos in those places. It has caused utter chaos in our area. We've got a prayer request still in our prayer list of someone who's lost homes and lost everything. We've heard so many stories over the last few months of the aftermath of what this terrible storm came through and done. We've heard about tornadoes, hurricanes, all of these tragic storms that have blown through, and they brought complete destruction. Well, the winds are glued to our television, and we're tracking the storm. How many remembers when we were younger that we would go to, some may still do it, you buy the little pamphlet, the little storm tracker, and you begin to put your red dots on it as it was coming through. But now we've got so much modern technology, we don't have the little pamphlet anymore. We're not putting our red dots, but we're watching play-by-play television stations. They cancel everything, breaking news, Weather Channel. When they send that one guy's name slips my mind, but you know when he's on the scene, the bald-headed guy, when they send him to the scene, it's going to be trouble. When you know that's where it's going to strike, that's where it's going to hit, Cantora. So we're waiting to see where they're sending Cantora, to see where he's going to show up at. And we know if he comes into town, I'm getting out of town, because that's where it's coming. So we're tracking it, we're watching it. We have that privilege of the technology. Would you have over in third world countries, Puerto Rico, Dominican, and places such as that, that they can't see it coming? A lot of them don't have the tracking devices. They do not have the internet. They do not have the ability. They just begin to see the trees moving, and all of a sudden the storm is upon them. Well, you may be asking this morning, Brother Jamie, what does that have to do with revival? Well, the wind bloweth where it listeth, and thou hearest the sound thereof, but cannot tell whence it come or whither it goeth. So Jesus compared the wind to the Spirit. He said, so is everyone that is born of the Spirit of God. We experienced a time of revival here at the Middleburg Church of God. We had services that we put it on our calendar. There's some, they'll tell you, almost to the moment when they believe that the storm is going to hit. Well, we went ahead and put on our calendar of when we felt that God would have for us to have revival. We put everything in place. We prayed for 21 days, fasted for 21 days, making preparation for revival. We had the Pooler family come. They sung. They preached. Revival winds blew in this house. The Spirit of God moved in every service. And people were praying around the altar, seeking for a closer relationship with God. The wind was blowing. The Spirit was moving. We took full advantage of that opportunity. We put some stuff on the back burner. We began to make adjustments in our schedules, didn't we? We began to move some things off our calendar and say, no, revival is in the air. The wind of revival is blowing, and I don't want to miss it. We know that the one service that we miss of revival is going to be the one that, boy, the wind blew through that house. So we came with a desire to see revival. It's not like a hurricane that we run from. Not like a tornado that we get into the interior room and stick our head between our legs and hope for the day. But it is a time that we've got both hands in the air and we're saying, blow, wind of the Holy Ghost, blow. Let the former and the latter rain together. Let the Spirit of God blow through this place. Let the wind of the Spirit blow. And I believe that in our revival, and that Spirit wind blew in the house of God. I love revival. I love being in the presence of the Lord. I love being in the house of the Lord. There's nothing like it when the Spirit of God begins to move and the preacher begins to preach under a mighty anointing night after night. Hey, I love the times when revival just goes on and on and on. That's what I love about our camp meetings. Brother Carl Thomas put it best. Camp meetings just like having Sunday all week long. Because we come in the morning, we come back at night. And we experienced a great camp meeting this past year. And we also experienced a great camp meeting in 2016. 2016, after camp meeting, I preached this message the Sunday morning after camp meeting, the aftermath of revival. But little did I know at that point, all the assessment had not been made yet. We hadn't got a chance to see the full result of it. I just let you know in that message that when revival comes, there will be results that will come from revival. I just let you know that go ahead and expect the unexpected. Go ahead and know that revival brought something that you didn't even realize. How many after the storm was all gone, you thought, well, everything's okay. You may have walked out there. We had this happen in Howard Road. We walked out there. Thought everything was good, found a couple of problems, but it was a little while later. I believe Sister Gill was driving through the churchyard, and she feels this bump, and she said, man, that root seems to be higher than it used to be, and we had a tree that had worked its way up. We didn't recognize it right after the storm, but as several weeks passed by, and we found some more aftermath of revival. So when I preached this message right after camp meeting, I didn't realize the full effects of what took place in revival, because as 2016 closed He said, I'm ready, Brother James. I said, what are you ready for? I kind of knew, but I wanted to tell him. What are you ready for? He said, I'm ready to get saved. So we can take care of that. So Kyle and I, we knelt down at the altar. I led him to the Lord. And we prayed together. Once again, the aftermath of revival and revival went with all the results of it coming in. But I didn't know until later that while Kyle and I were up at the altar praying and me leading him to the Lord, that in the back, Hillary, 8 months pregnant, turned around in that seat and she was pregnant. I believe Leland was 25 pounds, or Declan was 25 pounds when he was born. She was pregnant. In 8 months, she was ready to deliver. He was a big baby when he was born. And she turned around in the tightness. And he's telling me all the time, these chairs are too close together. I said, babe, I got to get as many as I can in here. So she bowed down in that tight 18 to 20 inches that we had between those chairs and knelt down. A few ladies gathered around her, and the difference was Hillary knew how to pray. Hillary knew how to get back in the right relationship with God. She turned her heart back over to the Lord there. That whole family came to the Lord.
It's the heart of where God is working, where God is moving, and God's heart is
Christ in Jerusalem. It's that central place of worship throughout the Word of God that you find is that place. So when we read this today, it does not mean in order for me to experience revival, I better get a plane ticket to Jerusalem. But we need to get to that spiritual Jerusalem. We need to get into a heart. What did he say to that woman in the well? That it's time that the worshipers begin to arise. It is time the true worshipers begin to arise. When they do, they worship God in spirit and in truth. And we enter into a heart of worship, and we're saying revival's coming. And Jesus said he's going to send revival. And God said he's going to send revival to the Middlebury Church of God. God told us to prepare for revival. And how did he tell us to prepare? To get to a place of worship. To get to a place that we begin to worship him and praise him and magnify him. Being sober and vigilant, looking for that adversary and enemy, but also keeping our eyes on the promise. God's about to do something. Wind's about to blow. So they did that. Then he told them in Acts 1 and 8 what was going to happen. But ye shall receive power after that the Holy Ghost has come upon you, and ye shall be witnesses unto me both in Jerusalem and in Judea and Samaria and in the uttermost parts of the earth. They were going to receive power. And he said, after the wind blows through, something's going to happen in you. And when you come out of that upper room, when you come through that time when the wind of the Spirit blows, it's going to be something different. He said, you're going to be witness of me in Jerusalem. Now we think of Jerusalem in worship, but we're going to be witness of him in worship. We know that, right? That when we're worshiping him, we're witness of him. People see a lifestyle of worship and praise, but not just in worship, but everywhere you go, in everything you do, in every act, in every deed, in every walk of life, on the job, at the schoolhouse. He said, everywhere that you go, there's going to be those that's going to see the aftermath of the wind blowing in and through your life. So are all of those that are born of the Spirit. When the wind of the Holy Ghost blew, he said, you're never going to be the same. You're going to be changed. And then it happened. Acts 2, 1 through 4. And I don't want to spend a whole lot of time on the wind. What happened during the wind, because I want to talk about the aftermath of it, but I do want to read it to you this morning. Acts 2, 1 through 4, when the day of Pentecost was fully come. Some say they were there upwards of 10 days. 10 days waiting for the promise. Waiting for the promise. They were one accord in one place, and suddenly there came a sound from heaven as of a rushing mighty wind. Don't know where it came from. Don't know where it went. But I know where it hit. Amen? Amen. And it filled all the house where they were sitting. And there appeared unto them cloven tongues like as a fire that sat upon each of them. And they were all filled with the Holy Ghost. And began to speak with other tongues as the Spirit gave them utterance. That wind blew through. That sudden power of the Holy Ghost that they had been waiting on, that they were expecting, but called them suddenly. That they were expecting called them unexpectedly. That it began to blow. They knew what the Lord had said, but yet it came with a mighty power. Listen, we believe that God's going to send revival, but sometimes when revival breaks out in the middle of our series of services, some people sit there shocked, and amazed, and in awe. What am I supposed to do now? God said, this is what I've sent. This is what I said that I'm going to give. This is revival. Revival began to blow through that house. Holy Ghost power began to flow in that place. They began to speak with other tongues as the Spirit gave utterance. Power of God moved in that room. And there was nobody bailing out. There was nobody saying, I don't want this. He said it filled all. And all were filled. They were all forever changed. And it was a wonderful time. But there, I told you earlier, there was 500 that he told to go. Who could tell me how many were there?
120.
Simple math. Even somebody with a Clay County education can figure this one out. 500 minus 120 is what? 380. And Gracie is working on this in school, greater than and less than. 380 is greater than or less than 120. Greater than. So the majority didn't even make it to Jerusalem. The majority did not take the steps room. The majority did not get there. But how many knows this morning that God does not move according to the crowd? God does not move according to what the majority chooses to do or not to do. But God saw 120. 120, and 10% of those were His disciples that had gathered, and His mother Mary, they gathered there in that upper room. They all made it to that upper room. They all made the journey to Jerusalem. They all walked up the stairs. And can I just tell you, not everybody makes it to revival meetings. Not everybody makes it to the revival service. But there are a group. There is a group that made it every service. There are individuals that made it to every one. Why? Because they said, I'm looking for the promise of the Spirit. They were saying, I'm hungry for something. I need more. I want more. It was not like the hurricane where they put up the hurricane shutters. It was not like the tornado where we're hiding in the bathtub. But we're out there for all and all exposure in the place of where it says it's going to hit. The storm chasers, while we're running from the storm, they're going to where the storm's going to hit. They're flying their airplane through the eye of the storm. When I was out in Oklahoma, they had these guys that they would chase down tornadoes. I heard that you can pay a price and ride with them. I want to do it. I love storms. But they run to it. They get as close to it as they possibly can. We need to be that way spiritually. Yes. That matter to me when everybody else is going, where are you going? Jesus said, go to Jerusalem. I'm going to Jerusalem. Where are you going? Well, I'm going to see Grandma. I'm going on vacation. I'm going to work. I don't know where the 380 went, but they didn't go to the upper room. Right. I don't know. As a pastor, I look around sometimes when we have revival. I don't know where they're at. Don't know why they didn't make it a priority to get here, but there was some that did. That day in that upper room, those that did, suddenly they heard a sound from heaven as a mighty rushing wind. And they said, I'm so glad I made it. I'm so glad I made it to the central place of worship. I'm so glad that I made the trip to Jerusalem, that I got in the upper room and I experienced the outpouring of the Holy Ghost, and their lives was forever changed. The Spirit of God moved. We say, oh, I want to be in that room. It would have been great to be in that room, but revival didn't stop there. The wind didn't stop there. The aftermath of it is still going on today. That we begin to see that there was a sudden thing that began to take place because they didn't keep it confined in the upper room. The wind blew through. They were all filled with the Holy Ghost. Things calmed down. They walked down the steps. And when they walked down the steps into the city, beginning to speak with other tongues, people from every nation was there, gathered there. And they began to hear them and them glorifying God in their own tongue. And they began to stand in amazement. And as they began to stand in amazement, we found that Peter stands up full of the Holy Ghost, full of power. Verse 14 of Acts 2, he says to Peter, standing up with the 11, lifted up his voice and said unto them, ye men of Judea and all ye that dwell in Jerusalem, be it known unto you and hearken unto my words. Hearken unto my words. And he preached a very short message. 3,000 souls. There's one fence post in my backyard. Had a little more damage to the church we had to take care of. There was some cost involved with it. But nothing like those images that I scrolled across there. Didn't have to face what they had to go through. I talked to many as I began to serve our community, trying to help people and begin to talk to people. They thought, I don't know what I'm going to do. The aftermath of it. They're still today trying to figure out how they're going to rebuild, how they're going to start over. That's the negative impact of a natural disaster. But the positive impact of a spiritual outpouring is so much better. There's an aftermath of both. But how many today would say that you're experiencing an aftermath of what revival has brought? Acts 2:37-47 said, now when they heard this, they were pricked in their hearts and said unto Peter and to the rest of the apostles, men and brethren, what shall we do? Peter said unto them, repent, be baptized, every one of you in the name of Jesus Christ for the remission of sin. You shall receive the gift of the Holy Ghost. Listen, those that want to keep this confined to Acts chapter 2, is ignoring Acts chapter 2. Because he said in verse 39, for the promise is unto you and your children and all that are far off, even as many as the Lord our God shall call. And with many other words that he testified and exhorted, saying, save yourselves from this untoward generation. Then they that gladly received his word were baptized, and the same day there were added unto them about 3,000 souls. And they continued steadfastly in the apostles' doctrine and fellowship and breaking of bread and prayer. And fear came upon every soul, and many wonders and signs done by the apostles. And all that believed were together and had all things common, sold their possessions and goods, and parted them to all men, as every man hath need. And they continued daily with what? One accord in the temple, and breaking of bread from house to house, and did eat their meat with gladness and singleness of heart, praising God and having favor with all the people. And the Lord added unto the church daily such that should be saved. Look there in verse 46. They continued daily with one accord. Then you look back in Acts chapter 2, verse 1. It says, when the day of Pentecost was fully come, they were with one accord in one place. So the very thing that the 120 did and prepared for, and that Holy Ghost outpouring, the same thing was the same thing that those afterwards had to do. Some say, well, I wasn't here for revival, Brother James. I didn't make the services of revival. I had to work. I had whatever. I was sick. Or just to be extremely honest, I just didn't make it a priority. Whatever the case may be. And you say, well, I guess I just missed it. Maybe now there's some regret when we hear how God moved and how God blessed and how Brother Pooler preached and how the Spirit of God was moving. And we think, man, I wish I could go back. Do you think maybe there was 380 people when they heard what happened in that upper room? Man, I wish I would have made the trip. I wish I would have been there. So this morning is not for me to say, oh, you should have been there. You should have been in revival. You should have been in those services. No, I'm telling you, no matter if you made the services of revival or not, that same wind that blew, that you can experience the aftermath of it, and that promise that came there for that day, it came for a purpose. It came for a reason. And God didn't just contain within 10 or 11 days of revival services, but God did something in that time frame that will bring an aftermath, that will bring results in your life and my life in days and weeks and months to come. How many can say revival messed me up? Revival messed me up. That's what I want. To mess up this flesh and its plans and its will and its ways. Revival changed something inside of me. Total devastation to the flesh. Total devastation to this flesh to realize how many has felt that feeling when a storm is coming and it's out of your control. There's one or two things you can do. Batten down the hatchets or run. Right? That's the same way when the Spirit comes. We can go ahead and prepare ourselves for it, or we can run from it. I don't want to run from His presence. Amen. I don't want to run from the Spirit. This flesh will tell you, don't go there. Don't go there. It's going to mess you up. It's going to cause you to have to change some things. It's going to change some things in you. He said that's the same. The wind that blows, you don't know where it comes from. You don't know where it goes. But it does something. It makes a change. It begins to bring results. That wind blows. It comes through here. It takes tree limbs down. It does all kinds of things. We don't know. We can't explain it. And it's the same way when the wind of the Spirit begins to blow through our lives. Begins to blow away. Begins to break away. Begins to take the flesh. Says, I don't want anything to do with that. But those that say, man, that's what I want. I want the wind of the Spirit to blow in my life. I want it to upset the plans of the flesh. Not my will, but thy will. Not what I want, but what God wants. I need a change. I need a difference. I need the wind of the Holy Ghost to blow. So we're like those storm tracers. We're getting in our spiritual automobiles and we're driving right to the impact point. We're getting in our spiritual airplanes and we're saying, I want to fly right through the eye of the storm. I want to be right in the middle of what God's doing. If God's wind's blowing, that's where I want to be.
want to be where it's hidden. I want to pinpoint God. So it's much different than that natural disaster that we want to get away from. But some are the same way with the Spirit. They don't want to be where the Spirit of God is moving. A backslider does not want to be in revival. A person that's running from God, that's lukewarm, that's cold and indifferent, saved and satisfied, they don't want to be in a revival campaign, a revival service, because they know what happens when the wind of the Spirit blows. It begins to change some things. It begins to beat away at some things. I shared with you the other day on Facebook a statement about water washing away at a rock. And it doesn't just happen instantly. It's a constant flow. And there's a constant flow that we need of the Spirit of God. That begins with revival, but it does not end with revival. Yes. That wind that blew through the book of Acts is still blowing today. The results that happened there in that upper room, they saw immediate results of 3,000 saved and saw such added to the church daily. But how many have been saved by the blood of the Lamb? How many born again folks do we have in the house? How many sanctified folks full of the Holy Ghost just wave at me this morning? What does that tell me? There's still an aftermath of what happened in Acts chapter 2. There's still an aftermath of what Jesus came to accomplish and said, listen, I'm going back to my Father, but it's not over. There's a big storm that's coming. There's a promise that's coming straight from heaven. It's going to blow through this place, and you better be there. Wish you could have been there, what the songwriter said, when the Lord saved me. I wasn't there when the Lord saved some of you, but I could see the aftermath of it by the way that you live your life day by day. I wasn't there when you got born again, Sister Gilda, that I could see the results of it every time that I see you. When I see you up here singing and worshiping, praising God. When I walk into a hospital room to visit somebody, Sister Gilda was already there. I can see that there's something that happened. There's an aftermath of the revival that took place in your life. So no matter where you were at when that wind blew, no matter where you were at during revival services, can I tell you that those that experienced revival, they're going to have an aftermath that's going to spread throughout the land. In closing this morning, if Sister Gilda would come, Brother Clint Bennett shared a story about a man that when he preached, he had preached just like this because of his vision. He had his message broke down. And he could not hardly see. Even with glasses, he would have to hold the paper that close to his face. But they said he was a mighty man of God. Powerful preacher of the gospel. And God is sent him to this place, this valley, to preach revival. And he had prepared, he had prayed, and man, he felt that God was going to do something wonderful in that meeting. He got to that meeting, got to those services. When he got there in those services, everybody was excited. Everybody had prayed and making preparations for it. But when he got there, it said 14 people showed up. 14 people showed up. Discouragement wanted to set in. But he grabbed that message that God had gave him. He held it up in front of his face. And he preached. He preached what the Lord laid upon his heart for that service. 15, I guess, counted the preacher. Experienced revival. Amen. Nobody else came. Nothing else happened during that revival campaign. Just those 14. They closed out their service. They went home. They may have said, man, church was good. Our brother preached a great message, challenged our heart. I'm glad that I was there. How many can say you were glad that you were in revival? Amen. I was glad that I was there. It messed me up. Some of them may have went to him and said, preacher, you messed me up today. I'll never be the same. My life has been forever changed. But the reality was, it was only 14 people. And he wondered. Though 14 people experience revival. Was it really everything that he really thought it was going to be? Well, what the revival is things begin to happen. But it was in the next 24 hours when those 14 people left the church house, went back to their homes, went back to their jobs, their occupations, their schools, wherever they went, hundreds being saved in that night. Why? Because 14 people experienced revival. The aftermath revealed greater results than they could have ever imagined when the wind was blowing in that house. And it must have felt good when the wind of the Holy Ghost and cold tongues like the fire set upon each of them. But it did not compare to what the Holy Ghost has done since those 120 believers were filled in that upper room. What did Jesus tell them? He told them to go there, prepare yourself for this outpouring. But he said the power comes in the aftermath, didn't he? It says, Randy, you pull it up again, Acts 1 and 8. That you shall receive power after the Holy Ghost has come upon you. So it's not during revival, it's during revival that we feel the wind, we feel the changes taking place in us, we feel God dealing with us, we feel God working in us. But there may be some feeling disappointed that we came to revival service after service, revival's closed out, I spent a lot of time in the altar, but I really haven't seen a lot of change in my situation. Hold on. Aftermath is coming. He come in the world, shut that up. Breakthrough is coming. Victory is coming. It's the aftermath. Hold on. Hold on. How many are looking for the aftermath? They have heard of earthquakes after earthquakes. There's little tremors that take place afterwards. Don't compare it to the earthquake. It's an aftermath. It may not be the same as when he shook the house, but you're fixing to experience some tremors. Your loved ones fixing to experience some tremors. They're fixing to feel a cool, gentle breeze that blows in. No, that's not the hurricane. That's the child of God. It's forever changed. Ever changed by revival. So hold fast. Don't lose hope. Because the power of God may not always work everything out right when you think that it will. One songwriter put it this way, he may not come when you want him, but he'll be there right on time. Brother Jacob, revival is coming on, and my situation is still the same. Hey, I feel you. I hear what you're screaming. But I know that in the Word of God, that though victory, though the power of his great victory didn't come until after, the results of revival come after the meeting is closed, the days and weeks and months to come. How do you know that? I just shared it with you earlier. It was not during camp meeting that these souls were saved. It was after camp meeting that they came to the Lord. It was not during camp meeting that Brother Stone got filled with the Holy Ghost. It wasn't even in church. He sat up on the side of his bed, Sister Debbie, in the middle of the night. Sister Mary did not know what was going on. He got up off his bed. She went looking for him. And he was walking through the house, speaking with other tongues. The Spirit gave up. He's been seeking for the Holy Ghost for 20-something, as long as I've ever known him. Been seeking to be filled with the Holy Ghost. It wasn't in camp meeting. It wasn't in Sunday morning service. It wasn't in a revival service. But it was the aftermath of revival. He was filled with the Holy Ghost. It was in the aftermath of revivals and miracles begin to take place. So God is doing great things. Thank God for revival. But revival comes and revival goes. But after revival goes, he said, I've changed out. I'm ready to work. And what he did is he's blown away everything. All the interference that did a work in those that were hungry for it. That they will leave that upper room. It was great in that upper room, but Scripture tells us they didn't stay in the upper room. It's so easy for us to stay in here and say, this is where revival happened. This is where I want to stay. No, he said, go. He had already told him, go into the highways and the hedges. Compel them to come in. So it's time that we take that walk down the steps and know, yes, revival services is closed. Poolers are in Hilliard today, I believe. They're going to their next meeting. But there's an aftermath that we're about to experience. There's some things that's fixing to be exposed. There's some works that God is doing that the devil wants to tell you, well, revival didn't bring you anything. God said, oh yeah. Oh yeah. Son's about to reveal the aftermath of revival. Are you ready to find that aftermath? live in that aftermath? Are you ready to go forth in victory in that aftermath of revival? I am. Will you stand with me this morning? Father, I'm so thankful for the opportunity to experience revival, to be a part of revival, to hear the preached word of God, to experience the anointed singing, and the gathering of the altars. Pray for my brothers and sisters to feel the power of God moving and working in areas of their lives. Watching people hungry and thirsty and desiring more of you, and the wind just blowing. Just blowing, stirring, the atmosphere charged, the Spirit of God moving in a mighty way. Lord, what I love more than that is the results that that brings in the days and weeks and months to come. Lord, and I pray this morning that we begin to realize that revival accomplished something. The writer said, will you not revive us again, O Lord, that thy people may rejoice in you. Father, if revival did nothing else, then it would bring back our rejoicing. No matter what's going on around us, we will rejoice. And I pray, Father God, that you help us to begin to step in to the aftermath of revival. Anticipating and looking for answered prayers, for miracles, and everything that comes after the revival campaign is over. We come each service with a great expectation, though revival was good, for the best is yet to come. Touch us as we come today with a great expectation for more of you. We praise you for it. Thank you for it. In Jesus' name, amen. Maybe you were not in revival services.